you, sorry about the delay, and I welcome you to this meeting of the cabinet today, on the 24th of February, well into the new year now. Okay, we'll start with the agenda, obviously, and the first one that we have is disclosable of conduct, declaration of interest. Are there any members of the cabinet? Sorry, first of all, apologies. Quite one apology, that's Councillor Lisa Leach, who is very ill at the moment. Okay, as I say, now we need to declaration of interest. Councillor Jones.
Yeah, thanks, Chair. Item 4, declare an interest as a director of the Board of Growth Coordinating, and I'll be leaving the room if I take some notes. Thank you.
Councillor Usher.
Chair, yeah, my declaration is the same as Councillor James, as I'm also a director. Okay,
thank you very much. Anybody else? Councillor Stuart, we've seen. Steps will be public outreach consultation and progression of planning applications, as we can see. opportunities in Birkenhead. By funding the first phase of office developments through a annuity lease funding model, this means a surplus will be created which will enable surplus contributions to be made towards the funding of the new Birkenhead market, as well as residential developments within Birkenhead, which would be otherwise unviable. The cross-subsidy of such surplus is a key principle of the Wirral Growth Company, and one of the key drivers for the creation of the company itself to realise the ambitions set out within the plan. As we take forward the regeneration of the borough, I want to thank all parties on this council for their support, who have been and continue to be consulted at every stage. And we all agree, of course, these plans are vital if we are to improve the quality of life for our residents. It's important we mean what we say, which is why key social, as I said, cultural and environmental components are embedded within the strategy. But the social value plan, if you look here in the report on page 23, and the culture and the climate change implications on page 23 as well. The social value plan is a key element, is it not, of our community wealth strategy. Shop local, keep it local, and of course we've got a great conference to follow on this. And through the Growth Company, the council of course will be an advocate of promoting energy efficient buildings while ensuring that any new developments minimise the impact on climate change. One example of this is that all office buildings proposed will be designed and built to green excellent standards, and the council putting in place a range of measures to accelerate progress to adopting a zero carbon environment, and the recommendations in this report will take forward to reflect those measures. As we prepare for town centre plans, we have also consulted widely with local residents and businesses, and their views are helped to shape and mould these exciting plans to ensure it's people led, bringing people with us, and of course as politicians it's vital that we listen to what the people say. Full details of the Growth Company communication strategy are included in the partnership business plan in Appendix 1 here. At a time of severe austerity and continued austerity for local authorities like ours, one of the main drivers of the Growth Company is that the profits from the schemes, including increased business rates and council tax, through the annuity lease that I mentioned earlier, will help protect those vital frontline services. It's also playing a vital role, is it not, with our local plan. Building on brownfield sites helps protect our green belt, and without it, we'll put those precious green belt sites at risk. In Birkenhead, we're witnessing with these plans the renaissance, I believe, and the rebirth of our main commercial district on a scale not seen since the town was built. In the days of Laird, I'm sure our forefathers will be proud of the plans we have to move Birkenhead forward into the 21st century. We are working on being together as well, a master plan, informed by that consultation I mentioned earlier. We also wait to hear if our bid for £10 million to set up an urban regeneration corporation has been successful, which will give us a dedicated resource to oversee our vision. This, I like the high street funding and the town's deal, all add up to a very meaningful focus on and direction. And one that sees us working in partnership with the Combined Authority, Homes England and Government North West. Funding and expertise bring forward the length and breadth of our wider ambitions, stretching it from Woodside to Hamilton Square to the town centre, to Wirral Waters and Hind Street and along the coast to New Brighton, for a scheme we are calling the Left Bank, a huge undertaking and possibly the biggest regeneration scheme, I would say, of its type in the North West when taken in its totality. So an exciting, transformational and visionary scheme will undoubtedly bring a new confidence to our communities that things can change for the better and the councils can make that change. We only have to look in New Brighton when we're all working together on this council to see that change can be made and that change can be successful. That's a prime example on a much smaller scale to this huge regeneration that we're about to witness over the next couple of years. And we can see that starting already, can we not, on Wirral waters where we see the diggers in. And you know, surely a lot more will be happening in terms of a ribbon of developments all around that corner, just by the bridges. And it gives people hope and it gives people confidence that things are on the move. And believe me, with this administration this year, allied with the help from our partners and from other members and other parties on this council, we do believe that drive and focus is unstoppable now. So, when we work together, particularly when we work together in new and innovative ways, so this is unique, the way we're working to bring this about. So I ask Cabinet to support the recommendations in this report. Now, if I can read out the recommendations, if I may, just give me a minute. Before I read out the recommendations, are there any comments from any members on Council Visiting?
The sun has been a proud lifelong Birkenhead. I hope the Valdi welcomes reports. Yes, the Wirral Road is not just about Birkenhead, it's for the whole world. But for me, the standout opportunity is that for Birkenhead. Combined with the options and the range of local plan, I think we're on the cusp of the regeneration of Birkenhead at a scale not seen since the days of the Laird, and it's been a long time coming. So I hope Valdi can support the recommendations.
Thanks, Stuart. Any other comments? As I said before, I won't read out the recommendations. It recommended that the Cabinet approve the Wirral Road Company Year 1-3 Partnership Business Plan, noting that it will be updated and reviewed on an annual basis. B, approve the draft indicative site development plans for initial priority sites, which are Morton, Ashford Road, Morton, Foxwood Road, Bromley, All Road, and Birkenhead Town Centre. Noting that these are indicative and final SDPs, which will be prepared and submitted for approval in line with the agreed site development process. C, note the following approval of the PBP, planning applications will be taken forward as appropriate for initial priority sites. No work on site other than site investigations and enabling work to take place until approval. Note the Birkenhead Commercial District Road Line for Town Centre. Development has been extended to include Birkenhead Market, recently acquired land, being announced stores. And land which the council is in the process of acquiring monthly payments. Approved the Birkenhead Commercial District for business case. Funding arrangements set out will be paused due to lease. Delegated authority to the Section 151 officer through the Wirral Road Company to appoint a commercial investment advisor to commence marketing. Finally, note the use of forecast business rates, income generated, and BCP available as a funding contribution to the project. I propose those recommendations. Can I second them? Yes, sir. Williamson, can we agree? Thank you very much. Okay, we'll go on to the next item on the agenda. Which is Wirral Youth Office, phase one, ages 37 to 78 in the hard copy. Councillor Tom Usher, when he comes back, is somebody going to go?
Yeah.
Okay.
Thank you.
27, consideration of proposals to implement selective licenses of body consultation, page 117 and 296 from the High Court. Councillor Whittingham.
Thanks, Pastor. It's a great pleasure to present this report to Cabinet. I believe, and I'm sure everyone around this table agrees, that everyone deserves the right to live in good quality, safe and attractive housing. There is the national housing crisis, and we are seeing a massive increase in the availability of private rented accommodation. Whilst we know that many private landlords are responsible and offer high quality housing to an excellent standard, but far too many don't. There are tools available to councils to tackle these road landlords who are quite happy taking the rent all too often from the public affairs and offer at best inadequate housing and at worst modern day slums. All the tools available to councils are suspected licensing. In 2015, the Labour Cabinet introduced a suspected licensing scheme in four areas of Cllr. I pay tribute to my predecessor, Councillor George Davis, for leading on this progressive policy. Some of the housing conditions that have come to light as a result of selective licensing have been truly appalling. Selective licensing gives the council the means to tackle these conditions and the road landlords to allow people to live in such conditions. Much has been achieved since 2015, however, there is still much work to do. And the report I was at this morning is seeking to redesignate the original four areas for a further 5 years and to extend sex licenses to the two areas as set out in the report. Our proposals shouldn't be confused with the recent experience of Liverpool City Council. Liverpool sought to introduce a city-wide landlord licensing scheme, which requires government approval. Because our proposals are targeted and are led by robust evidence, there is no need for us to seek government approval to introduce our scheme. I would like to thank officers for all the hard work and evidence gathering that has gone into producing this report, and I would like to have an invitation asking the Cabinet to support the recommendations as set out in the report. Thank you, Pastor. I would like to propose that we consider the recommendations.
Okay, I'll second it. Are there any other comments before we... Councillor Chris Jones.
Thank you, Pat. Being a seeking councillor, I've really seen the benefits of the schemes that we've got, so I absolutely welcome additional areas, because I think we've got a real problem, you know, that wards like Seacombe, we've got landlords who are converting buildings into houses where you might have 12 separate flats, you might have, you know, conditions which are, you know, not what we would want for people, and we're not helping areas like Seacombe. And I'm sure it's in Birkenhead and Birkenhead, you know, to enable people to live in good quality homes. And I just think, you know, that the selective licensing scheme has helped some of the tenants. But I think we really need to push this on. And I think, whereas I don't believe that we did it in the right way, trying to do the whole. We are doing it right, and hopefully it will improve conditions for people.
Councillor James, Councillor Julie McManus.
Thank you. I feel like the issue has been continued, and Councillor Davis has done good work. Unfortunately, for
on to item 8 on the agenda, community well building, pages 297, 332. Councillor Janette Williamson.
Thanks, Pat. I'm really excited to present this report today to my colleagues. This has been almost 2 years in the making, and it's been a result of a fantastic collaboration with Cllr. I've worked with Preston City Council, who obviously are at the forefront of community wealth building. And it's, as you mentioned at the start, there's a conference taking place after this cabinet today, which will obviously expand more on what we're doing here on Wirral. So I'd start off by saying that Wirral is a fantastic place to live. It really is. We've had £250 million nearly cut from our budget since 2010. We've been left to get on with it. While at the same time, we've seen central government's neoliberal economic policies wreak havoc on some of our poorest residents. Improving people's health and well-being is fundamentally about creating prosperous local economies that benefits everyone. And for me, that is central to everything that I do as a politician. I don't really think it's... for me, coming into politics was about changing people's lives for the better. And that's what hopefully I will be doing, and we will be doing as a council with community wealth building. We're all the difference in life expectancy between the highest and lowest is 12 years for men and 9 years for women. Health inequalities depends on what side of the world you're born on. It's not right and it's not fair. Inclusive growth represents an opportunity to address the considerable health and social inequalities existing within and between local communities on Wirral and across the city region. So, our community wealth building strategy. For me, this is about the failure of successive governments to rip up the economic textbooks and go back to basics. We don't live in a trickle-down economy as much as we keep getting told that. For me, it's a trickle-up one. Wealth is being extracted from our local communities and trickling up to those people who benefited the most from the kind of economy that we've lived in for years. We have to find a way of being progressive in spite of grinding austerity. So, what is community wealth building? It's a people-centred approach to local economic development. Community wealth building seeks to restructure the composition of the economy itself so that wealth is widely held, shared and democratised. It reorganises local economies to be fairer, stops wealth flowing onto our communities, towns and cities, and instead places control of this wealth into the hands of local people, communities, businesses and organisations. We have a real problem with inequality in our borough. The East has some of the most deprived wards in the country. There are the highest concentrations of child poverty, and household income is well below the national average. We need to change this. High levels of income inequality increases instability and debt. For too long we've been relying on trickle-down economics to solve issues of poverty and inequality, and now it's time for something different. There are three strategic objectives of this, our strategy. We want a democratic economy, an economy where decision-making power is shifted from corporate managers and shareholders to a larger group of public stakeholders, including workers, customers, the community. We want a generative economy, one that has built in tendency to be socially fair and economically stable. A generative economy is built on a foundation of stakeholder ownership designed to generate and preserve real wealth that is shared by communities. We want to build a resilient economy where families and communities hold assets such as social networks, a home, savings and ownership stake in a business and a secure job, and more able to withstand knocks such as job losses and illnesses that dealt out through austerity. It also means that public services and the community sector are less vulnerable to the shocks of austerity, budget cuts and economic recession. So our five outcomes of our strategy are that residents in Wirral will have ownership of the economy and have a say in what happens to the wealth generated by their communities. Procurement practices enable our communities and our residents to be strong, resilient and to be successful. And I believe that through our community wealth building strategy, that's exactly what we will do. Obviously, I'll expand a little bit more on our strategy in the conference. It is available there online for everyone to read through, and I'm so proud of it. Just lastly, we have also got a financial inclusion strategy attached to our community wealth building strategy. I felt this was really important because a lot of our residents have suffered massively through austerity. They are in poverty and they are in debt. And I thought as a council we need to take the lead and help those people with a formal strategy which addresses that. So our ambition for an inclusive economy and building community wealth is closely linked to financial inclusion. Financial inclusion means that individuals, regardless of their background or income, have access to useful, affordable and appropriate financial products and services. True financial inclusion doesn't just mean having a bank account. It means that people have access to the appropriate banking, credit, insurance, pensions and savings, as well as transactions and payment systems and the use of financial technology. When people don't have access to this, it's known as financial exclusion. I'm sure that we all have residents within our own wards that suffer from financial exclusion, where they pay more for being poor. This is not acceptable. The establishment of a community bank, which we'll talk about in more detail in the conference, will tackle financial exclusion. It's another really exciting development on Wirral. So, Pat, I'm really, really proud to lead the way here. This is probably my most exciting moments as a politician. I don't think I'm going to top this, and I'm happy not to, because this is something that I came into politics to do, is to help people and help this borough. So thank you all for your support.
Thank you for that. Councillor
Thank you. I'm absolutely delighted to support this really fantastic strategy. It's not only serving our community more fairly, it's also helping to ensure that we protect the environment by shortening supply chains, keep the things open. It's just win-win. I think it's actually a bad person now.
Councillor Spriggs.
Yes, can I also echo what a really fantastic and comprehensive presentation that was, John. And I know that this is because it's come from your heart. It's what your politics are all about. You're trying to make change, positive change in people's lives, trying to find ways, innovative ways, ways that have vision and passion. So it's absolutely fantastic. Really looking forward to the conference shortly. With my culture and creative sector hat on, there's a lot of synergy, obviously, between what you're talking about and what you've been doing and what we've been doing here on the Wirral. So we already are supporting creative businesses, CSCs, for example, like Hamilton, you know, leads and received at the conference. But it's all very well to sort of talk about that as some data. But this is local people, local young people with real skills, also with real passion to do something wonderful for their borough. And you know, when they get supported, as Tom mentioned earlier, with young people, they come back and give you so much more back. Meg Hamilton has taken over the old treasury building that wasn't being used. It's costing the council money to just keep it closed. Now there are 12, I think, local small businesses based there, creative businesses mainly, as a silversmith, which are artists. There are going to be gallery openings. It's going to become a real community hall. It's already started to happen. That's just one small example. I know they'll need more support to be able to really deliver what they can deliver. I know they're looking to start opening a community cafe soon and things like that. So very exciting developments. Fantastic that we've got that strategic leadership at the council, because you know maybe the next big thing is 1,000 small things, and it's something we need to think about a little bit more carefully. Thank you.
Fantastic strategy, fantastic document that's been brought to us this morning, and I'd like to congratulate Janette Item 10 now is the exempt information exclusion of the press and public. Just read what it says. The following item contains exempt information. Recommendation under section 100A for Local Government Act 72, public excluded from the consideration of the following items of business on the grounds that they involve the likely disclosure of the exempt information as defined by paragraph 3 of Part 1, Schedule 12A, as amended to that Act. Public interest test has been applied.